that good. Jesus saves. Since Jesus came into my heart, let's go to 435 together. 435. What a wonderful change in my life has been wrought. Let's all stand together as we sing. What a wonderful day in my life has been wrought since Jesus came into my heart. I have light in my soul, for which long I had sought since Jesus came into my heart. Since Jesus came into my heart. Since Jesus came into my heart. Floods of joy o'er my soul like the Sibylon roar. Since Jesus came into my heart. On that third, I'm possessed of a hope that is steadfast and sure.
Since Jesus came into my heart,
and my sin
was a doubt, sure.
Since Jesus came into my heart, since Jesus came into my heart, since Jesus came into my heart, floods of joy o'er my soul like the sea.
Church today, and this is a day of remembrance. We have September 11 that we'll all who lived through that. How many of you, I'm curious, how many of you young people in here were not alive September 11th of 2001? You weren't born yet. Let me see your hand. Put your hand up. Yeah, quite a few. Okay, thank you. You can put them down. And they're kind of, if you want to know what they feel like, they feel kind of like I feel like when they talk about Pearl Harbor, 1941. I know you think I was probably born then, but I wasn't. And but we don't, you know. But I remember and I understand the people that were affected by that in a great way. And we certainly want to pray for those who were affected by 9/11, lost loved ones on 9/11, and certainly the families of those first responders. You know, I thought about them this morning, and I prayed for their families, and I thought about what the Bible says, greater love hath no man than this, that a man lay down his life for his friends. And those men went into the building, into the towers that day, knowing that they may not come out. Yep. But they went in anyway to try to help some folks. And that's a great love that they have. But it also reminds us that life's brief. None of us are promised tomorrow. And we don't know what a day can bring forth. And I told our Sunday school class, you know, I'd like to compare the attendance in church today with the attendance in church the Sunday after 9/11 15 years ago. Churches were overflowing on that Sunday. And I wonder if it might be the attendance today might be closer to that of September 9th, 2001, 2 days prior to 9/11, than it is the week after. Because we've kind of gone all the way back to the way we were before those attacks took place. And that's a sad thing, because I think God got our attention, but we didn't give it to him very long. Amen? And we need to give him our attention. And so we're going to have special prayer now for our service here, and we'll pray for the families and those who lost loved ones in that attack, and we'll pray for our country as well, that they'll turn back to God. Let's pray together, shall we? Father, thank you for this morning, and Lord, thank you for this opportunity for us to gather together here. And Father, we live in America. We're Americans. And Lord, we do remember. many of us exactly where we were when we heard that a plane had flown into one of the Twin Towers, and then most of us watched it unfold on television. And then the plane and the brave men and women that thwarted the attack on Flight 93 that ended up crashing in Pennsylvania. And Father, we're mindful of how the country prayed after that, and we seem to look to you. But Lord, I feel like we've gone back to the old ways again and gotten away from you. And I'm asking you, Lord, to please work in the hearts of the leadership in America. Work in the hearts of individual Americans. Lord, work in our hearts. Turn us to you. And Lord, I pray that each of us would make sure that we're not part of the problem, we're part of the solution. And that you'll turn our hearts to you and use this service today to do that. I do pray you'd comfort the families who lost loved ones on that day. Lord, I pray that it would not be in vain, but that we would learn the lessons you wanted us to learn from that day. That as a nation, we'd humble ourselves and pray and seek your face and turn from our wicked ways. And I would ask you, God, as you gave that promise to Israel, that that promise would be good for us as well, that then you'd hear from heaven and forgive our sin and heal our land. And so, Father, we commit it to you today, and we pray your blessing on our service. And, Lord, as we focus on the Great Commission and our missions conference week, as it's upon us, that, Lord, you'll give us your heart today and speak to each one of us as only you can. It's in Jesus' name we ask it. Amen. All right, you may be seated.
Shadows the little village of his birth. His family all asleep, he lies alone. Gazing up toward heaven, a little tear falls to the earth, and he wonders if his sorrows here are known. His body racked with pain from his father's sharp disdain, he lifts his head and whispers in the night, if there's a God above, please send someone in love to comfort me and show me what is right. His brow was creased and wrinkled, his hands were calloused hard, his hair was gray, his body stooped with age. But his eye possessed a twinkle, and his gaze shot through my heart. His voice was strong, he looked at me and said, the harvest fields are white, and I have labored all my life. Now who will go and stand in my place? The people there must hear that Jesus Christ is near. Step forward now, the work of God embrace. How will they hear? How will they know? How will they ever find the truth if we don't go? Jesus desires every child his love to know. And around the world, in every tongue, to every nation, tribe, and clan, the gospel must be preached to every man. So who will go and light the way that leads lost souls to Christ? Who will go and lay down his life? How will they know? How will they ever
won't go.
How can we fear?
How can we fear?
God's love to show.
God's love to show.
Jesus desires
every child his love to know.
How can we fear?
How can we fear?
God's love to show.
God's love to show. Jesus desires every child his love to know.
Let's turn to 129, 129 in your hymnal. Mine eyes have seen the glory of the coming of the Lord. Battle hymn of the Republic. 129 on that first together.
Mine eyes have seen the glory of the coming of the Lord. He is trampling out the vintage where the grapes are ripe. He hath loosed the fateful lightning of his terrible sword. His truth is marching on. Glory, glory, hallelujah. Glory, glory, hallelujah. Glory, glory, hallelujah. His truth is marching on.
On that third,
he has sounded forth the trumpet that shall never sound retreat. He is sifting out the hearts of men before his judgment seat. Oh, be swift, my soul, to answer him. Be jubilant, my feet. God is marching on. Glory, glory, hallelujah. Glory, glory, hallelujah. Glory, glory, hallelujah. Our God is marching on. In the beauty of the lilies, Christ was born across the sea, with the glory in his bosom that transfigures you and me.
Let us die to make men free,
while God is marching on. Glory, glory, hallelujah. Glory, glory, hallelujah. Glory, glory, hallelujah. While God is marching on.
All right, some announcements now. Listen carefully, if you would. 5:30 today is our Christian growth class, and tonight's lesson is going to be on forgiveness. Forgiveness, and so we make sure you're there for that, and understand there's so many problems that people have, and side issues and other things that take place, even physical ailments, and at the root of it is unforgiveness that has become bitterness and has become a root of bitterness in them, and it defiles the body. And so we'll talk about forgiveness tonight at 5:30, and then tonight at 6:30 for the evening service, When Jesus Marvels. A lot of times we can stand back and marvel at what God has done and what Jesus has done, but there's time in the Bible when Jesus marveled at somebody, and we'll look at that this evening. Now, tonight at the conclusion of service, we'll be clearing the auditorium out of all the chairs and such. Our new carpeting is coming in the morning, all right? So by the time you arrive Wednesday night, there'll be new carpeting here, and we'll need folks on Wednesday to come in and help get all the chairs back in the auditorium and get things set up for church Wednesday night. But that remains now, just so everybody is aware, there'll be no food or drink in here with the new carpeting, okay? As many of you noticed the different spots and things in here already, and so just make a note, this will be enforced, okay? Not trying to be mean or unkind, but we are trying to protect the investment that in the Lord's property. Amen. And so we're going to take care of it the best we can. And you can, we don't hold you that long that you can't get through for an hour, hour and 15 minutes or so without a drink. And so that'll be in effect starting on Wednesday evening, okay? And I appreciate you doing that and thinking about that with us. Then this week, of course, as you see by the flags up, begins our missions conference. And this will be regular service Wednesday night, 7 o'clock as usual. Thursday night and Friday night, the missions conference will officially begin with 6:30 each evening, okay? 6:30 each night, and be a missionary, and Brother Cobb will be preaching each night, and you're going to enjoy it. We have the Inmans that are in Thailand, and we have the Burden family that are going to Indonesia. And then, of course, Brother Cobb and his wife, who have been at Baptist Bible Translators Institute. It's a place where they prepare missionaries, and they help them with linguistics. They help them with adapting to the culture, and it's just a great it's a nine-month training course. And Brother Moreland and his family have been there. I think the Yoders spent a month down there with them, and others will be going there. You're going to enjoy Brother Cobb. He's a delight. And you're going to enjoy his preaching through the time. Then don't forget, Saturday, 9 o'clock, we'll be meeting to go to the parade. We're in the Arts in the Alley parade on Saturday. And if you're bringing in candy for that, please, how many has thought you'd bring in candy, but you haven't done it yet? Let me see your hand. Anybody? Got one? Two? Okay. We need candy. Got some back here. We need candy that we can throw out during the parade with the John and Romans. We'll get an idea of how much we have there. We have 6,000 John and Romans to pass out along the route. And we do that during Saturday morning's parade. And then Saturday night, 5 o'clock, is the international dinner. There is a sign-up sheet for that downstairs, and sign up, follow the directions. We hope you'll all come to that. And then afterwards, of course, we come in here for the service, and that's at the conclusion of that service is when we present them with their gifts that you bought for them. And that's always just an exciting night and a great night to be a part of. So it's going to be a wonderful week, and look forward to Missions Conference every year. And it's here, it's exciting, and we're looking forward to what God's going to do. Okay? Now, also want to let you know of a ladies' conference coming up in Canal Winchester, Heritage Baptist Church. Reese Fowler, let's see, I don't think it says what year it is, but they've had it for many, many years. This year's theme is Life's a Journey, Just Passing Through. And that starts on a Friday night, October 14th at 7 o'clock. And then it goes also Saturday, I think from 9 till about 2 or 3 in the afternoon. Lunch is included in that. It's $20 for teens and $25 for adult ladies. But their money is due by October 2nd. There are registration sheets for this on the table downstairs, ladies. If you're interested, pick one up. And get your money in by October the 2nd to them, and that'll be exciting. They have to stop taking registrations after 175 ladies, so the sooner you get yours in, the better off you'll be. Okay, that's October 14 and 15. Okay, that's all I've got right now. All right, let's take a moment. We'll welcome any guests we have with us in the service this morning. Anybody here today for the very first time? And first time right here. And James? This your guest? Why don't you introduce him for us? Chanel? And Chanel, does she have one name? Do you have a last name, Chanel? I'm sure you do. Taylor? Good. All right. And good to have you today, Chanel. Thank you for coming. You live in Columbus? Great. Great. Appreciate you being our guest today. The ushers hand you a card. If you'd be kind enough to fill that out for us, we appreciate it. And we'll have a record of your visit with us. When the offering comes by, just put that in the plate if you would, and keep the pen as our gift to you for coming this morning. We're glad you're here. All right. Let's give this young lady a warm welcome, shall we?
Thank you. has been working to soften up a heart. All he needs is a willing servant to simply do his part. Can you imagine up in heaven the joy there is that day? As a sinner bows his head to pray, can't you hear the Father say?
Number 57 in your hymnal, 5-7 years I spent in vanity and pride, caring not my Lord was crucified, knowing not it was for me he died on Calvary. Number 5-7, let's sing that verse together. Years I spent in vanity and pride, caring not my Lord was crucified, knowing not it was for me he died on Calvary. Mercy there was great and grace was free. Pardon there was multiplied to me. There my burdened soul found liberty at Calvary. By God's word at last my sin I learned. Then I trembled at the law I spurned. Till my guilty
you're dismissed to junior church. Children, you're dismissed to junior church as we sing that last together.
Oh, the love that drew salvation's plan. Oh, the grace that brought it down to man. Oh, the mighty gulf that God did spend at Calvary. Mercy there was great and grace was free. Pardon there was multiplied to me. There my burdened soul found liberty at Calvary.
Amen. Good singing this morning. Let's go over to 316, 316. All my life long I had panted for a drink from some cool spring. Would you stand with me as we sing 316 together?
All my life long I had panted for a drink from some cool spring that I hoped would quench the burning of the thirst I felt within. Hallelujah, I have found him who my soul so long had craved. Jesus satisfies my longing. Through his blood I now on the huts around me till my soul
one another. Make somebody feel welcome, especially our guests. We'll come back and sing this last stages together.
And sought for riches, something that would satisfy. But the dust I gathered round me only mocked my soul's sad cry. Hallelujah, I have found him whom my soul so long had craved. Jesus satisfied my longing, through his blood I now.
Let's sing that last all together. Well of water ever springing, bread of life so rich and free, untold wealth that never faileth, my Redeemer is to me. Hallelujah, I have found him whom my soul so long has craved. Jesus said,
seated, and the ushers will come. I guess ladies interested in going to the retreat down in Canal Winchester at Heritage Baptist Church, you can get your registration money to Lindy McKeon, all right? She'll collect all that together and then send it in all at once, okay? So get that into her just as soon as you can, and she'll take care of that and get it to the proper place, all right? Let's pray, and we'll ask God's blessing on our offering this morning. Give as God has blessed and prospered you. Brother Pullable, lead us in our prayer, please.
Let's pray. Our Heavenly Father, we thank you for this day that you've given us, and thank you for this church that we've come here and have you have worship with you, and we ask that you'd be with each person today, and if there's one here that's not does not know you as Lord and Savior, we pray that today would be that day that they'd come to know you as Lord and Savior. And we do thank you for the offering that we can give back a portion you bless us with, and we pray that you'd be with us this day. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Thank you.
Take your Bible this morning, if you would, please, to Ecclesiastes chapter 2. Ecclesiastes chapter 2. Get to Psalms. Most of you know where Psalms is. Go to your right, you'll find Proverbs, and after Proverbs, you'll find the little book of Ecclesiastes. We're going to look at chapter 2, and we're going to read verses 12 through 17, and I'm going to begin on verse 12. I want you to join me on 13, then I'll read 14, and then together 15, we'll alternate like that so we can end together on verse 17. As our custom is, let's stand together to read the scripture. All of us standing to read God's word, and I'll start on verse number 12. And I turned myself to behold wisdom and madness and folly. For what can the man do that cometh after the king? Even that which hath been already done. Then I saw that wisdom excelleth folly, as far as light excelleth darkness. The wise man's eyes are in his head, but the fool walketh in darkness. And I myself perceived also that one event happeneth to them all. Then said I in my heart, as it happeneth to the fool, so it happeneth even to me. And why was I then more wise? Then I said in my heart that this also is vanity. For there is no remembrance of the wise more than of the fool forever, seeing that which now is in the days to come shall all be forgotten. And how dieth the wise man? As the fool. Therefore I hated life, because the work that is wrought under the sun is grievous unto me, for all is vanity and vexation of spirit. And let's pray together, shall we? Father, add your blessing, please, to the reading of the scripture here this morning. And Lord, I pray that you'll prepare our hearts, that we'll be ready to hear what the Spirit would say to the church this morning. Thank you already for the good music we've heard and for the fellowship together, for the good spirit that's in this place. And Father, we pray that you'll bless the special, and that, Lord, you'll continue to minister to our hearts and put our heart in tune with your heart, that we'll be able to listen, and you'll be able to accomplish what you desire in each one of our lives this morning. In Jesus' name we ask it. Amen.
Don't want you, Lord, but a word.
Father, we bow before you in prayer now as we come to the preaching of your word. Father, we thank you for what we've heard this morning and already in song. And Father, we bow before you now and ask that you would minister to us through the word of God. We believe the word of God is quick and powerful and sharper than any two-edged sword, that it will pierce even the dividing asunder of our soul and spirit, and of our joints and the marrow, and that it is a discerner of the thoughts and intents of our heart. Lord, I pray that you'll use this message today to be a help, to be a challenge, and even to be an encouragement to those of us who are here today, and those who might be listening by way of the internet. Lord, I pray that each of us would yield ourselves to your Holy Spirit, that you would have a free hand in each of our hearts and lives. Keep us from distraction. Keep our minds from wandering. And help us to focus on the only book you've ever written. In Jesus' name we ask it. Amen. In the book of Ecclesiastes, if your Bible's still open there, written by Solomon, it's the word that you find quickly as you read over the book of Ecclesiastes is the word vanity. Vanity means nothing. It means emptiness. And as he writes, he tells us that I went after a lot of different things, but it was always empty. I got a lot of things, but I still had empty on the inside. I learned a lot of things, but I still had empty on the inside. I acquired a lot of things, but I still had empty on the inside. How many of you are old enough to remember a guy named Graham Kerr, K-E-R-R? They called him the Galloping Gourmet. You remember that? He had cooking show before there were cooking shows. You know what I mean? And by the way, became a multi-millionaire. And in the midst of all the money and all the fame, when he did things that no one else had done before, he said this, in my quiet moments, I told myself, there has to be more to it than this. Fame, television program, money, anything he would want. And he said, in my quiet moments, telling myself, there has to be more to it than this. In an interview with Tom Brady, he was asked, Tom Brady said, why do I have three Super Bowl rings and still think there's something greater out there for me? I mean, a lot of people would say, hey man, this is what it is. I reached my goal, my dream, my life. Me? Brady says, I think, God, there has to be more than this. I mean, this can't be what it's all cracked up to be. I've done it. I'm 27. What else is there for me? And Croft, who was the interviewer, looked at Tom Brady and said, what's the answer? And Tom Brady looked at him and said, I wish I knew. I wish I knew. You see, Graham Kerr came to the realization there has to be more to it than this. Tom Brady, even though he's won Super Bowls and it's the that reached the pinnacle of what people would say is success in his profession of football, says there has to be more to it than this. And believe me, as a young pastor, when I stood over a 32-year-old young woman with an 8-year-old son and a 4-year-old daughter and conducted her funeral because she died of cancer, you look and say, there has to be more to it than this. There has to be more to it than this. If there's one thing I see in common with many people today, they live their life as though this is all there is. They live their life as though this is it. And commercials tell us that. Hey, you only go around once, so grab for all the gusto. Or it doesn't get any better than this. And if we're not careful, even as believers, that kind of philosophy rubs off on us. And sometimes we look at church or serving God or doing something for the Lord as, well, I don't know if I want to waste my time doing that. And those statements realize, make us realize, maybe we bought into the wrong philosophy. And the truth is, what I want to talk to you this morning is, this is not all there is. This is not all. The preacher here in Ecclesiastes is Solomon. And Solomon, as he writes Ecclesiastes, he's a miserable man. The phrase, another phrase in Ecclesiastes is a phrase, under the sun. In other words, everything that he's writing about is man's view under the sun. And he's finding out that man, if the only view you have is under the sun, there's no view of what's above the sun, beyond the sun, then you're going to be a miserable puppy. And that's where he was. He says, nothing under the sun satisfies me. Nothing under the sun fulfills me. Nothing under the sun fills the void I have in my soul. It's empty. It's vanity. I want you to look in your Bibles, Ecclesiastes chapter 1. Notice with me verse number 12. He begins his search here and trying to find satisfaction and trying to find what life's all about and trying to find happiness. He says in verse 12, I, the preacher, was king over Israel and Jerusalem. And I gave my heart to seek and to search out by wisdom concerning all things that are done under heaven. This sore travail hath God given to the sons of man to be exercised therewith. I have seen all the works that are done under the sun, and behold, all is vanity and vexation of spirit. Here he says, the first thing I did was I began to look and search for that happiness or what life's all about, and I looked first in education. He said, I gave my heart to seek and search out by wisdom concerning all things that are done under heaven. He says, I'm going to expand my intellect. I'm going to learn about everything. I'm going to become educated. I'm going to fill my mind. He wanted to learn all that he could learn. And he thought the place to do it is education. And by the way, America worships education. They think the answer to everything is education. And they're finding out that as you educate sinners, all they become is educated sinners. They just become more educated in the way they can sin. And we expect education to bring satisfaction to people. Or education to bring fulfillment to people. Education to fill the void that they have. But if satisfaction and peace came by education, then the quietest, most serene, most peaceful place you could go would be a college campus. And having one pretty close by, we know that's just not the way it is. That isn't the case at all. But yet we spend more money in America on education every year than almost anything else. But we're trying to expect from education what education cannot produce. And there are people in life, and some of you may know people, maybe you have family members, and they've just they're just perpetual students. They're just always going to school and always trying to learn something and always trying to, and they're in search for something. They're trying to fill a void that will never be filled with education. Won't happen. Bob Jones Sr. said, education without salvation is damnation. He was right. So Solomon studied everything. He studied everything. And you know what happened when he studied everything? He became a pessimist. He got a very dim and dark view in life. He says in verse number 15, notice what he said, that which is crooked cannot be made straight. That which is wanting cannot be numbered. I commune with my own heart, saying, lo, I am come to great estate, and have gotten more wisdom than all they that have been before me in Jerusalem. Yea, my heart had great experience of wisdom and knowledge. Verse 18, for in much wisdom is much grief. And he that increaseth knowledge increases what, church? Sorrow. He said, it didn't work the way I thought it would work. He said, I think things that are crooked will never get straightened out. Things that are lacking will never get supplied. Nothing ever is going to change. It's just worthless. It's useless. In fact, the more I know, the more grief I have, the more I find out, the more sorrowful I am. I wish I didn't even know the stuff I knew. That was education. So he would say, hey, I looked at education and I found out there's got to be more to life than education. Those of us in this room would know there's more to life than education. We would say, yes, there is. Now, let me just say, God doesn't place a blessing on ignorance either. Nothing wrong with having an education. Nothing wrong with learning. And certainly we should. But we don't worship that. And we don't look to that to provide what it cannot provide. And there's more to life than just trying to fill that void in your heart with education. Then he did something else. Look in chapter 2. Solomon said, verse number 1, chapter 2, verse 1, I said in my heart, go to now, I will prove thee with mirth. Therefore enjoy, what's the next word, church? Pleasure. And behold, this also is vanity. I said of laughter, it's mad. And of mirth, what doeth it? I sought in my heart to give myself unto wine, yet acquainting my heart with wisdom, and to lay hold on folly, till I might see what was that good for the sons of men, which they should do under the heaven all the days of their life. Someone says, I went for pleasure. I said, I'm going to seek out pleasure, man. I'm just going to live it up. I'm going to party. I'm going to have a good time. And yet, when he gets to the end of that, look at verse 10. Whatsoever mine eyes desired, I kept not from them. I withheld not my heart from any joy. For my heart rejoiced in all my labor, and this was the portion of all my labor. Then I looked on all the works that my hands had wrought, and on the labor that I had labored to do, and behold, all was vanity, emptiness, and vexation of spirit. There's no profit under the sun. Wow. Solomon, hey, he was in a position when he said, I didn't withhold anything my heart wanted. He could get anything he wanted. Most of us, we look at something, we say, boy, I think I'd like to have that, but I can't afford that. Anybody ever said that to yourself? Yeah. Like every day, a few times a day? Huh? I just can't afford to buy that right now. Solomon never had that issue. He saw it, he liked it, he bought it. He had plenty, he could get anything he wanted. And people think, boy, if I could just get anything I wanted, or boy, if I just had that money, or I just say, how do you know that's true? Because the lotteries keep having record numbers of people that play and record jackpots. The casinos keep turning over $2 million every month in profit. People are chasing things, saying, man, if I just strike it big, if I just hit the lottery, man, then I can get everything I want. Get everything my heart desires. And Solomon says, you get everything you think your heart desires, and it won't fill the void that's in your heart. It's still going to be empty. It's still going to be lacking. Those things don't satisfy. Credit card debt is at all-time high. People purchasing things that they can't afford, and they just get them anyway. thinking, now I'll be satisfied, but it doesn't satisfy. I remember evangelist Tom Williams talking about a man who'd come to him. This man was worth $100 million. Almost as wealthy as Bob Wallace. But this man was miserable. He was miserable. And because he was losing his marriage. And he confided in Tom Williams. He says, I don't know what to do. I bought her a bigger house. I gave her more money. I bought her more things. But it doesn't fix the problem. He says, I can't buy her satisfaction. I can't buy her love. Parents, let me help you. Don't just guide your children into fields, into careers where you think they'll make money. Don't you dare discourage your child from surrendering to serve God, surrendering to be a missionary, surrendering to be a pastor, surrendering to be a Christian school teacher, surrendering to serve God somehow by saying, no, there's no money in that. Hey, you want to become a doctor, you want to become something, there's good money in engineering. Be an engineer. Is that right, Brother Messer? Must be some other engineer, right? Yeah. That's what Matthew says. Yeah, not that engineer. A railroad engineer. And but parents do that. They want to funnel their child into where something where you're going to make some money. We get the wrong idea of thinking that, hey, and we then our kids think, well, the whole idea here is to get money. That's what life's all about. Listen, here's somebody who had 100 million of what you think makes life about, and you know what? He's miserable. Solomon had much more than that. What he's saying is there's more to life than pleasure. There's more to life than money. There's more to life than possessions. In fact, Solomon had all that, and he wasn't satisfied. Still a void in his life, still a void in his heart. Look in chapter 2 again with me, will you? So here's what Solomon did next. He tried education. He tried pleasure. Notice verse 4, chapter 2. I made me great works. What'd you do, Solomon? Well, I builded me houses. I planted me vineyards. I made me gardens and orchard. I planted trees in them of all kinds of fruits. I made me pools of water, to water wherewith the wood that bringeth forth trees. I got me servants and maidens, and had servants born in my house, and also had great possessions of great and small cattle above all that were in Jerusalem before me. I gathered me also silver and gold, and the peculiar treasure of kings and of the provinces. I got me men singers and women singers, and the delights of the sons of men as musical instruments, and that of all sorts. So I was great. I was great. And increased more than all that were before me in Jerusalem. Also my wisdom remained with me. No one ever accomplished, humanly speaking, what Solomon accomplished. These are amazing things that he spoke of here that he did. And by the way, building the temple was an amazing accomplishment. You read about that in 2 Chronicles. It was a tremendous building and incredible to look upon. Things made of gold and marble and cedars of Lebanon. And then when it talks about the palace, didn't even mention much, just said he built him a house, but his house took twice as long to build as the temple did. It was magnificent. And then pools of water surrounding it. And then he took the pools and he used some of those pools to irrigate the orchards, to take care of the fruit trees. That's unheard of. He had the first irrigation system. He's a brilliant man. And in anybody's eyes, you look at Solomon, he'd be the epitome of success. There he is, Solomon. In fact, the Queen of Sheba traveled to see him. Why? She read about him in Forbes magazine. Fortune 500. It was Solomon, Solomon, Solomon. She goes, man, I got to go see this guy. He is great. And so she went to see what it was all about. And she even had to admit, I went to see it, and guess what? The half wasn't told me. You read about it and think, oh, that's too much hype. They can't have that much stuff. He can't be that great. She goes, man, he's greater than what they wrote. It's incredible. She couldn't believe what she saw. And yet in all of the midst of that, with the education that he sought after and sought no knowledge, and the pleasure that he didn't withhold anything from himself, and then the success that he sought for and he achieved, the things he accomplished with his life. And yet Solomon, in his quiet moments, said, there's got to be more to it than this. This cannot be all there is. You think these achievements would have satisfied me, but they don't. You think that having all the possessions and the money that I have, that would satisfy me, but they don't. Still empty on the inside. Don't think that just climbing the ladder at work is going to satisfy you. Don't think that if you just get the raise, or if you just get more money, or you just can get a bigger house, or you just can get a different car, just if I can just get, and then I'm going to be happy, then I'm going to be satisfied. It won't satisfy you, my friend. It won't work. Solomon had the life. He had what you would call the life. And he wasn't satisfied. He was empty. He thought education would bring happiness and satisfaction. He thought pleasure would bring happiness and satisfaction. He thought success or making a name for himself would bring it. But none of those things filled the void that was in his heart. Nothing did. He was still empty. And finally, in chapter 2, in verse number 17, you know what he says? Therefore, I hated life. Now, looking on the outside, looking in, you say, man, if anybody's got the life, that's Solomon. And sadly, sometimes God's people, Christian people, look at the world's people who've got money and have fame and have success, and we say, man, they've got the life, and you don't know the misery they're living with. If they have such a great life, how come they're shooting up with drugs? They have such a great life, how come they're so depressed? How come they're seeing psychologists and psychiatrists? And they're trying to find out, you know why? Because all of that doesn't fill the void in their life. And you should not be envious of sinners. Every Christian ought to stand up and shout to Solomon, Solomon, this is not all there is. There's something else, Solomon. You know what it is? It is knowing Jesus Christ and serving Him with your life. Hey, it's not under the sun, Solomon. It's above the sun. And it's not the S-U-N, it's the S-O-N. That's what you need in your life. You need Jesus Christ. Solomon had everything that Americans are striving for. Everything that Americans believe will make them happy, satisfied, or fulfilled. The casinos are buzzing. Lotteries are hitting record jackpots. The football stadiums are full. People living for position, for pleasure, for success, for fame, for riches. But I remind you, there's a heaven and there's a hell. Don't live for things that do not matter in eternity. Don't live for the things that will not matter in eternity. I meant to bring a pencil with me this morning. There's what? Is there a pencil here?
Is that a good one? Yeah. That's what I need. Thank you. I'll put it back. I was in high school. That probably surprises you because I... And I remember a fellow, I was in the Fellowship of Christian Athletes. A fellow come and talked to us one day, and he said, you know, he said, I want to challenge you with that pencil right there. And think of it this way. Think of that eraser part right there. See how small that is? He said, that would be representative of this life right here. And think of the rest of the pencil as eternity. What do you think you ought to spend your life on? That little bit there? Or all this here? And boy, that just made sense to me. Why would I waste my time on that little bit? I should live my life for the pencil, not for the eraser. What is he trying to do? He's saying, why don't you spend your life on something that matters? Not on something that's not going to matter in eternity. I never forgot that. Because God's placed a void in each one of our hearts, each one of our lives. It's only going to be filled with the eternal. It's an eternal void that's only going to be filled by something or someone that's eternal, and that's Jesus Christ. I remember reading Charles Colson. He was one of the attorneys for Richard Nixon during the Watergate thing. He's the only one that spent time in jail, by the way, in prison. But God used that for good. He started Prison Fellowship. Thousands of men have come to know Christ their Savior and been discipled in the Bible because of that. He's in heaven now. But he talks about how he got born again. And it was a friend who was much younger than he was, but a friend he really respected, admired, because he was became the president of a company that had become nationwide and hundreds of employees. And I mean, this guy could have anything he wanted, and he had a nice place to live and such. And he had talked about a meeting that he had with this man, and there was something different, and he knew something was different about him. He didn't ask about it that time, but the next time he got together, he asked him about it, and this fella gave him a book to read, and he told him the story. He said, I've got anything I want, and I can have anything I want. He's getting paid millions of dollars as a CEO of this company he was CEO of. Wife, two children. You know, he had the life. He said, but I'm laying and I'm thinking in my quiet moments, is this all there is? He said, I was in New York City for a business meeting, opened the paper to see if there's any show I'd want to go to on Broadway. But what caught his eye that day in the newspaper was Billy Graham was preaching at Madison Square Garden. And he said, there was something in me that said, I think I'll go hear him. And I'm on my way into Madison Square Garden and way up into I think it was the third level. And he sat up there amongst the 20,000 people that packed that arena and listened to Billy Graham preach the gospel. When he gave the invitation for those to come forward and receive Christ as their Savior, that multimillionaire CEO got up from his seat and made his way all the way down from the third balcony, from the third level of Madison Square Garden, and stood at the front, and he said, I gave my life to Jesus Christ to be my Savior. He gave that testimony to Chuck Colson, and Chuck Colson listened, and then took the book that he gave him. Chuck Cole said he sat out in his car and read that book, and he said, I don't know what was going on, but I just wept like a baby. I couldn't stop crying. God did a work in his heart. Hey, there's a guy who was a successful lawyer. His office was next to the office of the president in the White House. You leave the president's office, the very next one was his. Pretty powerful position. But there was a void in his heart. And he knew nothing, the success, the money, it doesn't satisfy. It doesn't fill it. There's got to be more to it than this. And this is, listen, there is more to it than this. What is it? Knowing Jesus Christ as your Savior. Serving God with your life. That's what it's all about. Don't miss that. Don't go through life and not know what that's all about. That is really living. Steve Jobs, who was the president of Apple, and he passed away. But when he was president of Apple, he tried to get John Sculley, who was at that time the president of the PepsiCo Corporation. He tried to get him to leave his position as the CEO of Pepsi and come work for him at Apple. And what he, and by the way, he, after turning him down often, he said, there was one statement that he made to me that caused me to resign and go work for him. You know what statement it is? That a question, really, that Steve Jobs asked him? He asked him this: John, do you want to spend your life selling sugar water, or do you want to change the world? Wow. Do I want to spend my life on something that is not going to matter? Or do I want to change the world? And by the way, I would pose that question to believers. What are you going to spend your life doing when you have opportunity and you fill in the blank? Or do you want to have an opportunity to change the world for Jesus Christ? You know what a missions conference is? An opportunity to change the world for the cause of Jesus Christ. An opportunity to get the gospel to those who've never heard. An opportunity to see people's lives change. An opportunity to turn our world upside down. And it needs to be turned upside down, because it's upside down now. And if it gets turned upside down, it'll be right side up. It sure needs help. And the gospel is what does it. God's people living for Jesus Christ is what this world needs. Got to have God's people to stop living like unsaved people. God's people living godly, not just Sunday, not just when you walk into church, but Monday and Tuesday and Wednesday and Thursday and Friday and Saturday, every day of the week. You see, when you face Him one day, and all of us will give account of ourselves to God one day, it isn't going to matter how much money was in the bank account. It isn't going to matter how nice the house was. It's not going to matter what title you held at work. It isn't going to matter how many possessions you accumulated. Didn't matter. It's not going to matter how full your garage was or how many storage units you could rent. What's going to matter is, did you know Jesus Christ? And what did you do with your life that He gave to you? Did you serve Him with your life? I want you to take your songbook this morning. Would you look there and turn over to number 218 in your songbook, will you? While you're doing that, I'm putting the pencil back on the piano. Living for Jesus. Do you see what the songwriter wrote here? Living for Jesus, a life that is true, striving to please Him in all that I do. Yielding allegiance, glad-hearted and free. This is the pathway of blessing for me. O Jesus, Lord and Savior, I give myself to Thee. For Thou in Thy atonement didst give Thyself for me. I owe no other master. My heart shall be Thy throne. My life I give, henceforth to live O Christ, for Thee alone. It's a great song all the way through. But as I thought about, and I never think about 9/11 or any great event that takes place where people lose their lives, but I think how many were ready to meet God? How many went on to eternity that morning and realized it didn't matter I had an office on the 87th floor of the World Trade Center? It didn't matter that I had a great view. I thought I'd arrived and I'd reached, you know, the one of the best places in my profession. But it didn't matter when death came that day. Straighten your priorities out, won't it? Let's listen to the wisest man the Bible says ever lived, Solomon. Let's listen to his counsel. Let's listen to, notice, the last verse of this says, living for Jesus through earth's little while, the eraser on the pencil. My dearest treasure, the light of his smile. Seeking the lost ones, he died to redeem, bringing the weary to find rest in him. Would you make the chorus your prayer this morning? O Jesus, Lord and Savior, I give myself to thee. For thou in thy atonement did give thyself for me. I owe no other master. My heart shall be thy throne. My life I give henceforth to live, O Christ, for thee alone. Make that your prayer this morning. It's the only life that satisfies. It's the only life that fills that void in your heart. That's what living is all about. Don't listen to the world. Don't listen. Here's a fella that did all that the world says you ought to be chasing to find happiness and satisfaction. And he says, I'm telling you, it's emptiness. You won't find any group of millionaires that'll sing, I'm satisfied with money. But you'll find a bunch of Christians that can sing, I'm satisfied with Jesus. It's a great life. It's a grand thing to be a Christian. It's the best thing I know. Let's pray together, shall we? Father, take the truth this morning. Thank you. Thank you for what Solomon recorded for us here. As he sought for fulfillment and happiness and satisfaction in everything under the sun. And it's not there. Remind us afresh and anew today, God, that only one life, so soon it will pass, and only what's done for Christ will last. Oh, help all of us. Help especially the young people in this room to live their life for Jesus Christ. Not to chase after those things that the world says you need to have to be happy. You need to have to be satisfied. Oh, may they listen to a wise man who's been down that road and say, listen, it's empty. Listen to others who've been down that road and say, I've been down there, I've done that, it's empty. I'll tell you what counts. Knowing Jesus Christ and living for Him, that's what counts. Oh, help us. Turn our churches back to You again, God. Our nation will come back one person at a time. Our nation will turn back one church at a time. Let us turn to Thee today, God. Thank You for a great salvation we have in Jesus Christ. Thank You for the fulfillment and the satisfaction that You give us when we yield our lives to You. Heads are bowed and eyes are closed. I'll finish the prayer in just a moment. I wonder how many folks in this room this morning here would say, Pastor, if I died this morning, I know that I'd go to heaven. I mean, if I left church today and a car swerved over center and hit me head on and I was instantly taken into eternity, I know that I'd wake up in heaven. I'm confident of that. I know Jesus Christ is my Savior. Would you slip your hand up for a moment that I may see it? Say, Pastor, that's me. I know that I'm saved. All right, you may put it down. Here today and would say, Pastor, I don't know for sure that if I died, I'd go to heaven. I don't know. I have that assurance that something happened to me that I know where I'm going. Would you let me pray for you? I'm not going to embarrass you, not going to call you out, but I'll remember you in prayer. Say, Pastor, I'm just not settled on where I'll spend eternity, but I appreciate you praying for me. Would you slip your hand up and back down and say, Pastor, pray for me? You couldn't raise it the first time, but you'll raise it this time. Is there somebody like that? Let me pray for you. Okay. God bless you. The message was to believers this morning. What makes life worth living? I wonder if the Spirit of God stopped at your chair this morning, spoke to your heart. One of the worst feelings in all the world is to be successful at something that will not matter for eternity. I wonder if you're here today and would say, Pastor, the Lord has spoken to my heart. I don't want to live life for the eraser. I want to live life for the pencil. I want to live life with eternity in mind. I want to realize those are the things that's going to bring satisfaction to me, not the things that the world says will. Pastor, the Spirit of God spoke to my heart today. Please pray for me this morning. Will you slip your hand up, Christian? Say, pray for me this morning. Yes, yes, yes. Thank you. That's what it's all about. Don't miss serving God with your life. Don't miss keeping Him in the right priority. Yield yourself to Him this morning. In a moment, I'll pray and we'll have our invitation. If you're here this morning and you've never received Christ as your Savior, I'll pray. When I'm done praying, the pianist will play. Bob will sing. We'll stand to our feet. Folks who want to come pray at the altar, they'll come and pray. You just slip out from your seat, meet me right here at the front. We'll have someone take a Bible and show you how you can know when you die you'll go to heaven. Greatest thing you'll ever find in all your life. Let someone show you how to be saved today. So when you know, when you walk out the door, if anything happened to you, you go to heaven. If you're here today and you're saved and you've never been scripturally baptized, then you ought to come and say, Pastor, it's time for me to be baptized. If you're saved and baptized and you believe this is where you ought to belong, then you come and say, Pastor, we believe, Lord, have us belong here and begin to serve here. Then you come. Be glad to have you come and welcome into the fellowship of our church. Whatever it is that God's dealt with your heart about, I want you to obey Him this morning. Father, thank you for speaking to hearts today. I pray, Lord, now that your will be done in each heart and life, that every individual you've spoken to will respond. Lord, we would bow our knee to you and say, I owe no other master. My heart will be your throne. My life I give henceforth to live for thee, O Christ, alone. Help us not to put anything else ahead of you. Have your way now in every heart and life, and I'll thank you for it. With your heads bowed, stand to your feet. As you stand to your feet, our pianist will play. As she plays, Bob's going to sing. God has spoken to your heart. Respond to Him this morning, will you?
Living,
that's right,
for Jesus, a life that is true, striving to please Him in all that I do, yielding allegiance, glad hearted and free. This is the pathway of blessing for me. O Jesus, Lord and Savior, I give myself to Thee, for Thou in Thou atonement didst give Thyself for me. I owe my heart shall be thy throne. My life I give henceforth to live, O Christ, for thee alone. Living for Jesus, who died in my place, bearing on Calvary my sin and disgrace. Such love.
I give myself to thee, for thou in thy atonement didst give thyself for me. I owe no other master, my heart shall be thy throne. My life I give henceforth to live, O Christ, for thee alone.
Do the chorus one more time.
O Jesus, Lord and Savior,
make it your prayer to God today.
I give myself to thee, for thou in thy atonement didst give thyself for me. I owe no other master.
Seated for a minute, if you would, please. Appreciate your attention this morning, your patience. We are glad to have Betty Griffin coming this morning. BJ, as most of you know her, BJ has accepted Christ as her Savior, but she is coming today to follow him in believer's baptism. Amen. Isn't that good? We're happy for BJ. God bless you. Been a long time coming, and I'm glad she yielded to the Lord on that. And you going down, okay? Follow Miss Kay downstairs, please, and she'll get you set. Praise the Lord. And then we're glad to have Gary and Tara Van Sickle. And Gary and Tara have been coming. When did you start coming? February. Yeah, that's right. It was February. That's right. He said it was towards the end of I Love My Church month. That's right. And just been a great couple for us and faithful. And they're coming for membership this morning in our church, and they've both been saved and baptized. And in fact, they were saved about 8 years ago over at Central Baptist Church when Brother Tim Lapish was still there as pastor. And through the transition there and everything, they fell away from church and fell away from the Lord for a while. And it was through the radio broadcast that Gary started listening to on the radio that God began to pluck those chords again in his heart about living for God, and so they started coming to church, and now they're serving the Lord here, and we're excited to have them on board with us, and excited about what the Lord's going to do in their life, and praise God for that. All those in favor of welcoming Gary and Tara into the fellowship of our church, let it be known by a hearty aye, and opposed by like sign, amen. That's great. All right, when we get done and we'll baptize, we'll go to the back, you come back with us, and make sure you stand as folks come by and welcome you into our fellowship, okay? Glad you're with us. Praise the Lord. All right, we'll go down and get ready to baptize BJ. Brother Bob? All
right. Well, let's sing a couple songs while they're getting ready. Anybody have a song that they'd like to sing? We haven't sung it for a while. Melinda? What a friend we have in Jesus, all our sins and griefs to bear. It is number 345. 345.
Forfeit, oh, what needless pain we bear.
Yes, sir. Number 41. There is a fountain filled with blood drawn from Emmanuel's veins. There is a fountain filled with blood drawn from Emmanuel's veins. And sinners plunged beneath that flood lose all their guilty stains. Lose all their guilty stains. Lose all their guilty stains. And sinners plunged beneath that flood lose all their guilty stains. Abigail. Number 91. 91. Oh, what a day that will be. What a day, glorious day that will be. 91. There is coming a day when no heartache shall come, no more clouds in the sky, no more tears to dim the eye. All is peace forevermore on that happy golden shore. What a day, glorious day that will be. What a day that will be when my Jesus I shall see, and I look upon his face, the one who saves me by his grace. When he takes me by the hand and leads me through the promised land, what a day, glorious day that will be. Let's sing that second. There'll be no sorrow there, no more burden to bear, no more sickness, no pain, no more parting over there. And forever I will be with the one who died for me. What a day, glorious day that will be. What a day that will be when my Jesus I shall see, and I look upon his face.
Savior, and in obedience to his command,
yes,
I baptize you, my sister, in the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit, bearing the likeness of Jesus' death, and raised in the likeness of his resurrection. Yes. And the servant said, Master, it is done as thou hast commanded, and yet there is room.
Yes, sir. 56. The old rugged cross. On a hill far away. On that first together.
On a hill far away stood an old rugged cross, the emblem of suffering and shame. Till my trophies are
Deborah. Number three. Amazing grace, how sweet the sound.
Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I'm found. Was blind, but now I see.
Ladies, sing that second.
"'Twas grace that taught my heart to fear."
Man, how about that third?
Let's stand together, shall we? Don't forget, 5:30 tonight for our Christian growth class, 6:30 for the evening service. And don't forget, ladies, the retreat information's down there on the table, as well as the sign-up sheet for the international dinner Saturday night. Okay, so sign up and be praying for a great week for our missions conference, all right? Let's bow together. Father, we thank you for this morning. Thank you, Lord, for speaking to our hearts today. Thank you for these decisions that have been made public this morning. BJ, obeying you in baptism. Thank you, Lord, for the Van Sickles and their, you leading them to become members here at Bible Baptist Church. And I pray we'll be a blessing, an encouragement, and a help to them and their family. Thank you for leading them our way. Dismiss us now with your care. Give us a good afternoon. Bring us back this evening for the services. It's in Christ's name we ask it. Amen. I'm so glad I'm a part of the family of God, Brother Bob.
I'm so glad I'm a part of the family of God. I've been washed in the fountain, cleansed by His blood, joined hands with Jesus as we travel this sun. For I'm a part of the family. Family of God.
Amen. You are dismissed. We'll see you.